The Diamond Sutra. Beyond mind, the realm of Buddhas. As such as we are, mind oriented. Mind is nothing else but sum total of thoughts that keep on coming moment to moment. And none of these thoughts are yours. All thoughts comes from outside. Buddha says all that we are is the outcome of our thoughts. Your mind evolves out of your thoughts. Mind is made up of your thoughts. Thoughts arise as an interaction between objects and beings and conditions created by memory, understanding and ego sense. These are the few attributes of the mind. And what are the attributes? Memory, which is known as Hindi chitta. Then understanding. Then ego sense. These are your qualities. Through these you interact in the realm of objects and beings. Objects means you are going through the busy marketplace or through a department store or through a mall. Your inner light through the eyes fall on this object and that object. You are like a child who is accompanying his father. He sees one object and insists on getting that. No sooner than the shop, he moved away from that shop, his eyes light falls on another object. That becomes the center of his attraction and he forgets about the first object and wants that one. And he is very sure that this is the second one that he wants, not the first one. When he goes through his next place, again his mind changes. This is interaction with the objects and beings. You are going through the marketplace. You see many people. I am just mentioning, using the word people, not men and women or children. One you like, next one you do not like. Someone you go on thinking about. So with these, many thoughts arise in you. If a man speaks or acts with a thought arising out of his inner oneness, happiness follows him like a shadow. One wonders how does this relate to new mind, because man can think purely and control his thoughts and thus he can obtain happiness. Then why new mind seems to appear to be contradictory to controlling things? There are three possibilities of mind. First is evil mind, which lives in a destructive way. Constantly, the inner pot is dirty, no matter how pure or crystal clear thing you put into it. It gets mixed up with the inner dirt of the pot. It always thinks of destroying and in the process enjoys creating suffering for the people. You will find these people all around you who cannot see even a single good thing in anyone. To such a mind, Buddha says, misery will follow like a shadow. If you want to create misery for others, you will be creating misery for yourself ultimately. One who does not seek the welfare of the other cannot find anything good for himself. If you are against existence, existence will be against you, because existence mirrors all that you are. It echoes you moment to moment. If you abuse, abuse will come and fall on you. If you sing a beautiful song, this song will come back and shower upon you. If you go to a place where there is an echo, or in the valley, in a valley, and you utter a single word, it comes back to you as its echo. Whatsoever you give comes back to you a thousandfold. Whatsoever you sow, you will reap a thousandfold. So the evil mind is followed by misery. Misery comes to him like a shadow. The evil mind is one who enjoys torturing, destroying, and murdering. Timur Lane, Genghis Khan, Adolf Hitler, and Joseph Stalin are the best examples of the evil mind. Then there is the holy mind. This is, evil mind is one extreme, the holy mind is another extreme. It is against the evil mind. It is just diametrically opposite to the evil mind. It is creative. It enjoys seeing people happy. It helps, serves, and rejoices bestowing happiness on others. It loves to see people happy. Happiness follows like a shadow to this mind, the holy mind. Yet still there is one thing more that you are not aware of. If happiness is there, then just beyond it, somewhere, happiness will also be present. If unhappiness is there, then somewhere on the boundary, happiness will be present. Both go together. These are the pair of opposites, like two sides of the same coin. Arjuna had asked in Bhagavad Gita that what is the nature of a yogi. He says yogi is equipoised. The phrase that he uses, one word to encompass all these diverse situations. Sitoshan sam dukkha. Sheet is cold, ocean is heat. Sam means equipoised. This is why this word is beautiful, it means equipoised. And out of this another word comes sama, a state that brings equanimity. A state that brings equanimity. In Sanskrit, the words are like a phrase. You have to extract the meaning just by changing the hyphens or the place where the two words are joined. To the word sam, just adding the sound of a, make it sam, it carries a different meaning. Sitoshan is written as one word, and for extracting the real meaning, you have to break it into two. I have heard there was an atheist. He did not believe in God. He has written everywhere, God is nowhere. God is nowhere.
Very good.
All around his work, on his walls, anywhere he could find a place to write. It happened he had a daughter, and the daughter was 3 years old. She was learning the words. She could not pronounce any word that has more than 2 or 3 letters. She saw the word written, God is nowhere. Now, if you, how nowhere is written, N-O, no, one word, W-H-E-R-E. She read the place where the words are joined. She took the W from where and joined it with no, because she could pronounce the words with 3 or 4 syllables. So no, when you add W, it becomes now. God is now. And from where, when he removed W, then H-E-R-E. And she read the sentence as, God is now here. And she asked Father, Father, you wrote this, God is now here. It was astonishing to the atheist. He said, where did I write God is now here? God is nowhere. He wrote God is nowhere, but with her bent of mind, the 5-year-old daughter read it as written, God is now here. Both possibilities go together. It all depends on your frame of mind, how you look at the world and everything. Evil mind is followed by misery and hell, but somewhere hell is always followed by heaven. The holy mind is followed by happiness, but happiness is followed by unhappiness, because they cannot be separate. They are embedded into one another. They are not two phenomena, instead two sides of the same thing. The example of coin is the most beautiful example. How can you be happy if you cannot be unhappy? Happiness is the canvas on which unhappiness is written. The contrast has to be there. If you write on a white board with a white marker, it will not be seen. On a white board, you have to write with a black marker. On a black board, you have to write with a white marker in order to find the words written. If you have forgotten what unhappiness is, you will have forgotten happiness too. It is the realization of one that gives you the experience of the other. It is the realization of one that gives you the experience of other. If you have never known disease, you will never be able to feel your well-being. It is impossible. To keep alert that you are healthy, sometimes illness is a must. You cannot write with a white ink on a white paper. Not that you cannot write, certainly you can write, but nobody will be able to read it, including even you. Contrast is necessary. To write with a white ink, you need a black piece of paper. The black functions as a background, and against that background, white ink becomes visible. So is life. Your happiness is like the white ink that requires a black background. The holy man lives in happiness but his happiness is a figure and unhappiness is there like a background. Without unhappiness, he will never be able to know what happiness is. Without contrast, there is no way to know. So ultimately, the holy mind and the evil mind are not separate. Instead, they exist as two minds. Instead, these are two sides of the same coin. The saint and sinner exist together. The existence must balance the equation, the alchemical equation. In the same proportion the atrocities increase, in the same proportion the religious or the holy activities increase. The saint and the sinner exist together. The saint can turn into sinner any moment and the sinner can turn into saint any moment. They are not far away. It is said, episode in Valmiki Ramayana, the original Sanskrit composition, there was a robber, his name was Ratnakar. He always used to rob the people, the travelers passing through the forest. One day the wandering sage Narad, whose status is just like Khizr alayhi salam according to Islamic tradition, the wandering mystic, he was captured by Ratnakar. So he asked Ratnakar, "You are doing this, why are you doing this? Capturing the people, robbing them?" He said, "I am doing this to support my family." He said, "That's right, you are doing to support your family. The act of robbing the people you are doing, and the benefit of that goes to all the other family members, your wife, your parents, your children. I would like to ask you one question. The punishment for the act of robbing that you are doing, who is going to bear the burden of that when the day of judgment comes? Will your wife, your children or your parents share that burden of the punishment that is there for you for the act of robbing?" So he thought it was a relevant question, but he thought maybe it is a trick to escape. So he said, "You seem to be," Ratnakar told Narad, "that you seem to be wise. There I go to inquire this from the family members, and on coming back, you find that you have disappeared." He said, "No, I am an honest and a straightforward person. You can tie me to this tree and I will stay here until you return." Narad was a fearless being. Ratnakar tied Narad to the tree with a rope and went to inquire. When he asked his parents, "I am doing all these things to earn a livelihood and to give you a comfortable living, but there is a punishment for the act of robbing that I am doing. Are you going to share the burden of that punishment when it comes to me?" Everyone, one by one, denied. He said, "That act is yours. I have nothing to do with that. You are responsible for it and you have to pay the price for it." It was an eye-opener for the Ratnakar. He came back and fell at the feet of Narad. He said, "You have opened my eyes. No one in the family has agreed to bear the slightest burden of the punishment that will fall upon me because of this act. Now you tell me the way out to come out." He was illiterate. He was a robber. How can you speak to the robber, what kind of technique has to be given. If your priest is there, he will look into any scriptural injunction, a particular mantra, a particular ayat, a composition from the scripture, any scripture that you know has to be given. But Narad looked deep into the person. His very being knows only one thing, killing. The Hindi word for killing is mara, means death, mara. So instead of telling him the other way to chant the word, his mantra that was given to him, say mara, mara, mara. When you use mara two times, mara, 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 what sound comes out? When you say this word three times, the sound that emerges out of that is Ram. If he had told him to chant the name of Ram, the Lord, the two-letter word, he would have not been able to attain to that state of transformation. Instead, he told him to chant the mantra, Mara, Mara. And when you are saying it in a fast speed, Mara, 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 so the sound that echoes out of that by using the labial, the words with the labial sound comes out to be Ram. And he continued. It said that he sat in meditation and continued chanting the word that has been told to him by the wandering sage. He remained in that state of meditation for a very long period of time. The dust, the rain, water and everything gathered on him. Even the ants made the nest onto his body. And he attained to enlightenment. And thereafter he became a sage known as Valmiki. And it was he who composed the first epic in Sanskrit, Ramayana, the story of Ram. And when during the time when Ram abandoned Sita, it was in the hermitage of Valmiki that Sita got shelter and grew up as his daughter, where she gave birth to two of Ram's children, blood and flesh. So two stated it. The saint can turn into a sinner any moment, and sinner can turn into a saint any moment. Just something is needed to trigger the process. They are not far away. They live very close to one another. They are very intimate. Their boundaries meet and merge into one another. Yet still there is a third mind. And this third mind know it as no mind. It is neither saintly nor sinner, a neutral mind. Neither happiness nor unhappiness. The duality is dropped. It is beyond the mind. It has experienced something which is beyond pain and pleasure. Sitosha Samadukha. One who is not bewildered by the pain or the pleasure. One who remains equipoised under all circumstances and situations. You would have seen a little problem has come and we get panicked. But a man of equipoise does not panic under any circumstance and situation. Simple act, this is not an act of teaching. Simply, whatsoever you have learned, whatsoever has evolved out of your own inner growth, becomes the way of your life. You may be saying your prayers or chanting your mantra life long, but it has never found its roots in you. It simply remained in you like the plastic flower with plastic roots, they can never bloom. And even if the plant was real, but your hard soil was barren, nothing could grow there. First of all, before you plant a flower plant or a tree or a seed, the soil, the bed has to be prepared. And when the bed is prepared and a seed is planted, then it begins to grow. So Master first of all prepares the soil of your heart. He brings your energy from all the lower centers, from nafs to kalp. And that process is known as your biological heart becomes a spiritual heart. The moment biological heart becomes a spiritual heart, the soil is prepared and then the seed can be planted. This process of making the biological heart into a spiritual heart is the second stage of initiation. The first stage of initiation is bringing your energy through that process when your energy moves to the various lower centers and reaches to the center of your life, the solar plexus, the fire center, where it generates a tremendous fire. Remember, when you are flying in a plane starts moving at a very minor, very small pace, very low speed, continues to, if you are walking a little fast, you can catch hold of the plane. It reaches to a point where it gains momentum, and that momentum is necessary for it to change its gear and go and reach to the higher altitude and fly in the air. So when you reach to that, it gathers momentum. The plane there at a particular place on the runway stops completely. Its gear is changed. It gains momentum. And the moment it gathers momentum, you can see the space, the speed of the plane changes. And within a few seconds, less than 60 seconds, its front wheels raise. That is the first thing it has to do. And it is now airbound. So when your energy is moving from the lower centers, the earth center and the water center, and reaching to the solar plexus, the center of life, it is the point where you are now ready to be airborne. A different kind of energy is required for you, for the plane, for the vehicle to reach, to attain to the state of airbound. And when it reaches, again there has to be a change, shift in the gear, where it can maintain its that speed and continue to cruise until the next stage comes, the third initiation. This first initiation, when your life, your journey of innerness has to become airbound. That process is known as first initiation. There are people who need to be given the first initiation, then the second initiation, when the plane is completely airbound, it has to cruise. When it is reaching, attaining the state of airbound, you are supposed to keep your seatbelts on. When it has reached to the certain altitude, it is cruising at high speed and you are unaware. You are asked to remove the seatbelt. Now you can remove your seatbelt. There will be no disturbance, no turbulence, as if you can just sit down in the plane and nothing shakes. This is the second stage of initiation and then comes the third. So the two stages remain close by. They are also very intimate. Their boundaries meet and merge into one another. And the third stage is the stage of no man. It is neither saint nor sin, neither happiness nor sorrows. The duality is dropped. This is beyond duality. It has experienced beyondness. Then there is silence and serenity. Then there is peace. All turmoil has vanished. Remember, even happiness is a turmoil. So too, happiness is a kind of fever. You like it. That is one thing, but it is a fever. Have you not washed it? When you are happy, you start getting tired of it. Once in a while it is okay, but you cannot remain happy for long, or you cannot go on laughing all the time. You must attain to the other stages. But you cannot remain happy for long. Sooner or later you become fed up with it. It is tiring. So too you become tired of unhappiness one day, and then from an unknown horizon, happiness lurks through. If you are too happy, you will not be able to sleep in the night. In the same way, if you are too unhappy or sad, then too you will not be able to sleep at night. You will not be able to relax in either of the two situations. Happiness becomes tense. Both are tiring. When happiness tires you, you move towards unhappiness. When unhappiness tires you, you start moving towards unhappiness. This is how the pendulum of life goes on swaying from one extreme to another. No mind is a totally different phenomenon. It has nothing to do with mind, happiness or unhappiness, holy or unholy. It is simply the taste of the beyond, the state when you are neither happy nor unhappy. Have you ever noticed, experienced even for a moment that state? If you have experienced that state even for a moment, the light will not remain the same. Do you remember when Bodhidharma went to China, the emperor who asked him a few questions? One of the questions was, I have created many monasteries, made many Buddha temples. I have opened my treasures for the spread of Buddha's message. Is it not holy? And Bodhidharma laughed and responded. And Bodhidharma's laughter was a roaring laughter, a laughter of a lion. What is holy in it? It is a kind of business. You are planning for the other world. You are hoping for heaven. There is nothing holy in it. It is as unholy as anything else. What does Bodhidharma mean by it? He is saying that your so-called holy acts are bound to be followed by unholy things. Deep down, the very desire makes everything unholy. The emperor was embarrassed and shocked and angry. He said, then, what do you think is not Buddha of a holy person? And Bodhidharma laughed again and responded, Buddha is never holy, not a person. Buddha is never holy, not a person. He is utter emptiness. How can holiness exist there? It will be a kind of dirt. is utterly silent. He is emptiness embodied. He is emptiness embodied. The state of mind, the state of no mind, is neither holy nor unholy. Buddha is neither a saint nor a sinner. You know either a person as a saint or a sinner, but you do not know what state, what kind of person you can call who is neither a sinner nor a saint. He has transcended the duality. Buddha is the transcendence. Remember, from one evil mind, you can become a holy mind. However, this is not real transformation. It is only a question of degrees, and you have not gone beyond the mind yet. Only no mind can live with. Therefore, never try to become a holy person. Holy persons are unholy, and never try to become a saint, because all that effort is nothing but an ego trip. There is nothing like mind. This is like mind playing a new game, and the game is subtle. Just drop that holy nonsense of being holy or unholy. Go beyond the saint and sinner, beyond both darkness and light, beyond heaven and hell. This is the first step. Beyond this is the realm of bliss. Bliss does not have any end. Totally new world which you have not even dreamt of. There is utter serenity, peace, harmony and oneness. No turmoil, and not even a single ripple arises. That state is the state of Buddha. This is the realm of Buddhas, Krishnas, Christs and Mohammeds. There is neither pain nor pleasure, because pleasure is not different from pain, and pain is not different from pleasure. Then what remains there? There is utter emptiness of silence. Buddhas are silent about that state. Nothing can be said about it. Only you have to be that. Because whatsoever can be said will become the part of the duality. Only that is why it becomes difficult to speak of that state of emptiness. Only an experience. You are listening to this talk, the words are overflowing that you are listening, but along with the words follows the silence. The moment your focus changes from the words to the silence, then you attain to the state of equanimity. And that state of equanimity is the state of realm beyond the doing. That will bring you to the state of equanimity. And that state which, that effort that leads you to that state of equanimity even for the moment is known as sama, and sama becomes a meditation. If you say it is bliss, then you will think it against the backdrop of misery. If you say it is light, then you will think it is not darkness. If you say it is summer, then you will think it is not winter. If you say it is a kind of flower, then you will think it is not thorn, but you will start thinking in duality. Buddha remains absolutely silent about you. The reason is that it can only be expressed in silence. Truth is experienced in silence and lost in the clatter of the mind. Truth is experienced in the silence and lost in the noise of the clatter of mind. It is silence. How can you express? silence through sound? No, you cannot. Silence can only be expressed through silence.